sing this. Again, and oh, the blood of Jesus, we sing, oh, the blood
of Jesus,
we sing, oh, the blood of Jesus, it washes white as snow. Thank God for His blood, the shed blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, gives us life and gives us hope and strength. Amen. Amen. Today we're blessed. I asked Chris to stay up here for just a minute because I want him to share something from his heart in regard to, you saw that slide that came up in regard to courageous. We have been talking about sowing, and I think that we can do this in a very, very practical way. Anyways, the Lord laid something on his heart as he's a Caseyville police officer. For those of you that ever speed through Caseyville, you will know that. Or if you ever get in a pursuit, he'll follow you. They will hound you like nobody's business. They will come after you. And so anyway, is that the truth? As far as you know, yeah. I want you to, Lord laid it on his heart to after seeing the movie Courageous. I don't know how many of you have seen it. And anyway, I don't want to spoil your thunder. So you just share just a moment about what the Lord spoke to your heart about.
After being a police officer and after seeing the movie Courageous, and I'm sure many of us that's been out for a while have seen the movie Fireproof, but we all know why police officers were created. So firemen would have a hero, so that's why they had to come out with another movie to make... I'm kidding. Just kidding. It was a great movie, and there's some things that, after seeing the movie, that I was like, wow, you know, I mean, I need to put some practical use to some stuff in my own life because of the schedules and everything that we work. And many of you know, talking to different ones here that are police officers, the territory that comes with. And I believe in the movie so much and what it stands for. God laid it on my heart that we need to bless our community. And the police officers in Granite City, we'll start with Granite, and then that's all I thought about. And then he started preaching the prayer of Jabez, and I thought, well, there's Pontoon, and there's Illinois State Police, and everybody else, too. But we're going to start by blessing our hometown guys. And God just put it on my heart that we need to purchase the movie Courageous and give one to every police officer in Granite City.
Amen.
I was talking to Jeff a little bit about this morning. I don't think it needs to be a big fanfare and, you know, a big name stamp to it or anything, but with Pastor being a chaplain, the plan right now is we need to purchase 59 DVDs. If we buy them in bulk, it's cheaper. So if you just want to make a donation, you can do that in an envelope or just see Betty. And if you want to write a check, you can put in the memo or whatever what it's for. I wanted to test the water. So what I did is I purchased it for the guys just on my squad, and it went over really well. I had really good feedback from them, and that was just a couple weeks ago, and they've all already watched it. And so again, I just believe in this. I think it's something really good. If you have any more questions, you can see me or Pastor about it. And the plan right now is Pastor being a chaplain for the police department, we'll have some ladies get together, wrap them, and we'll just have them put in the mailbox at the police department.
Amen.
Wonderful. You know what? Where are you going? I think that this is something that we can do in a very, very practical way. We appreciate so much the service. Police officers, whenever they go into situations, they're typically there because something went wrong. Something's bad. You know, he alluded to the firemen. We love firemen. We thank God for the, man, I like fires being put out. But I'll tell you what, oftentimes, you know, they don't get applauded whenever they show up. They don't get thanked whenever they get you, they pull you over. I'm just simply pointing that out, all right, for what it's worth. I want to be the first. Now, I realize that Jim Smith already beat me to being the first. Because you know what? Whenever this was mentioned the very first time, he went out and bought five of them on his own. Just boom. And so to my, I think there's only about 55 more that we need. And so anyway, I want to make it 54. And I know that 20 would be, that would be one of them. And I guarantee you there will be others. I want you. And I'll tell you what, if you appreciate the work that the men and women of this this city do, we want to bless them. And in regard to what he said, I think that we would just put a simple letter that we appreciate the sacrifice that they make every day. They don't know the things that they face. They don't know what that next call will lead to. And they put their lives in danger every day. And we appreciate that. And we honor that. And they are indeed public servants. And again, I'm not trying to downplay firemen. I thank God for them. We'll bless them another way. But this is what was laid on his heart. And I think we ought to just get behind it.
Amen.
Amen. All right. That's enough. I think I've said enough. Thank you. I'm finally going to let him go. Thank you so much. Thank you. You want to be number three blessing. I'll tell you what, he'll be out in the foyer after church. You can come up here, and we'll make sure that all of those things get purchased. I'd like to do that quickly so that we can bless others. I want you to turn with me in the book of Genesis. We have been talking about the prosperity of God, the blessing that God brings upon our life. Over the past weeks, we've considered a number of things. As a matter of fact, our key verse has been John 10:10. I am come that you might have life and that you might have it more abundantly. Let me tell you what I'm feeling in my heart and spirit. It's this, that whenever you begin to preach this, that very first part, the enemy shows up in a powerful way. The enemy is trying to kill with physical help, with physical strength and killing and destroying lives and hearts and even stealing, taking away that blessing and those blessings of our life. We recognize him, and it says when the enemy is caught, he has to return sevenfold, according to the book of Proverbs. And so we want to commend God's blessing and commend God's blessing upon you. It's not because of what we have done or how good we are, but rather because of our covenant relationship with God that we can hold to these promises. It wasn't because Abraham was the only, or the whatever, he didn't walk on water, or he wasn't deity, but rather it was because of his covenant relationship with God that his life was blessed. I believe God wants your life to be blessed in that same way. I think it's important to know how to receive and how that we can, as we've learned how to sow, we've understood how to sow. As a matter of fact, folks are so good about sowing, and even I guarantee you that there will be a wonderful outpouring of sowing into this courageous movie, sowing. But I believe that there's also that reaping and the benefit. What will it be in our city? I don't know. It might be that crime rates go down. Your house is worth more. Amen. Okay, thank you. You don't want to lay claim to that. All right. I believe that God blesses, and there is always a reciprocation of what we sow. It comes back to us. It reciprocates. It brings back to us. And so I believe that we've learned how to sow. I believe also it's important that we learn how to act and how to the art rather of receiving, and it doesn't come naturally. Sometimes there's opportunities and blessings and harvests that are missed simply because we don't recognize them, or we don't take them, or don't receive them. Has somebody ever tried to give you a compliment and you talked them out of it? Has somebody ever tried to bless you with a meal and you talked them out of it? I've stopped doing that. I'm going to I love to bless, but I'll tell you what, I also recognize and I'm thanking God for his blessings that comes back. Sometimes we need to receive. You realize that gifts and things, answers to prayer, compliments, rebukes. You don't think rebukes are ever a blessing? One of you guys sent me an email about the, I can't even begin to tell the whole email, and basically it was this Amish preacher or Amish family that had written a sign, and it was something to the effect, and it was written in such a way that it couldn't understand what was being said in there, and they were thinking, well, you're just trying to keep us off of this road. And actually what he was trying to say is the bridge is out. Sometimes there's rebukes, there's good news that we need to receive so that we won't be in danger. To receive, it means that your life is blessed by the things, whether physically or spiritually. I believe that God wants to bless us. Turn over with me to the book of Genesis. And I want you to see this. Whenever you think about this, I want you to take time to realize that this is all around us. There is practical illustrations of this all around us. Have you ever thought of about like this? Maybe you read a book on gardening. Maybe you go out and you pick the right seed. Maybe you go and you harvest up, or you break up your ground and you prepare it. You take all the weeds out. You've done everything. You sow it according to the book. You water it according to the book. It gets good sunshine. You even fertilize it. It grows up and it produces, but you never go out and eat of it. I wonder how many times that we have done that very thing. We have spiritually prepared the land. Spiritually, we've sown the seed. Spiritually, we've seen the growing, but yet we've never taken of the fruit. I believe that it's time that we recognize the harvest, that the harvest is all around us. And as a matter of fact, the book of Genesis chapter 8 and verse 22, it says it this way. While the earth remains, seed time and harvest, cold and heat, summer and winter, day and night shall not cease. There will always be, as long as this earth is here, there will always be seed time and there will be harvest time. There will always be. Sometimes harvest doesn't always come whenever we expect it. There are different seasons and different harvest times. Now, whenever we're talking about this, we understand that seed time and harvest is always perpetual. It continues on. It's God's program, and so therefore, He makes it happen. He's the Lord of the harvest. Just the same way that cold and heat, different seasons come. We thank God for them. As a matter of fact, sometimes whenever it gets messed up a little bit, it messes up the whole system. They're telling me that because of our warm weather that there might not be bees to pollinate the flowers. I don't know. What I do know is this, that God is He's the Lord of the harvest, and He knows how to bring seed time and harvest. He knows how to do it, and I'm not God. He is. So how do we do this? Let me just talk to you first about receiving or reaping or harvest time. First thing, there's three words on your paper there I want you to notice. The very first is this, that reaping is relational. In other words, what you sow, you reap. What you sow, you reap. Be not deceived. God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. So it is relational. It's related to what you sow. Whatever you put in. He says, if you sow to the flesh, you'll of the flesh reap corruption. If you sow to the Spirit, you shall of the Spirit reap life everlasting. So anytime you sow spiritual seed, you can expect a spiritual harvest. I believe when you sow physical seeds, that there are physical harvests that come. The second is this, it's conditional. You have to sow. Don't go out and just plow up your garden and expect tomatoes just to come up. I've done that, it doesn't work. We understand that it's the same way relational. Whenever I sow tomato seeds, I don't expect cucumbers. It's relational. I know that this is gardening 101 for many of us. It's conditional. Sowing, conditional. It's conditional. Do you know that sometimes I think that we have to sow even whenever it's not convenient? I'm going to tell on Chris. Chris wasn't feeling well this morning. But you know what? Pushed right through it. He didn't tell anybody. All right, well, I saw somebody said, oh, I think he's got a fever. Get rid of this. You sow germs, you get sickness. It's conditional. It's conditional. You got to sow. The third one there. Well, in your paper, I want you to know that it's proportional. He said, if you sow sparingly, you'll reap sparingly. You sow bountifully, you'll reap bountifully. In other words, if you sow one seed, don't expect there to be like a whole row of it. So it's proportional. There is proportion that comes in regard to condition. Whenever we do it, even whenever we don't feel like it, when we do it and we give and we sow those things, even whenever we may not feel like it, I believe that there are blessings that come to it. Whenever we pray, even when we're not feeling it, whenever we sing to the glory of God, it's not because I feel it. It's rather because of who He is. That's why I sing. It's not because it's my favorite song. It's rather because of who He is. He deserves the glory. So whenever we look at this, I want you to go on down in your paper. And there's a passage in the book of Luke chapter 4 where Jesus has gone back to His hometown of Nazareth. And He went to the temple and the synagogue, rather, and He began to read. They handed Him the scroll. He read from the book of Isaiah, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because He has anointed me to preach." And he basically declared, "I am the Messiah. I am here." And He said, as a matter of fact, He said those words as He handed the scroll back. He said, "Today, these words are fulfilled in your ears. I'm fulfilling the prophecy. I'm here. I'm it." But yet it tells us that they begin to say, "Isn't this Joseph's son?" You remember the story, maybe, in the book of Luke. If you don't, you can look there. But what I want you to notice is this. They missed Jesus. They missed the harvest of all of those prophetic years that had come. They missed the blessing that came to them simply because they didn't recognize Him. They didn't receive Him as Messiah. Even though the blessing that He brought was real and it was for all of them, they did not receive it. They didn't recognize Him as Messiah. They didn't recognize Him. They refused to recognize Him as anything more than just another man. You go on, though, in those next verses, in verse 24, in 25, 26, and 27, He then tells about two other incidents where there were people that were in need, that there were those that received and those that did not. And the key to them receiving, what was it? The next one, if you read on down, it's a passage from the book of 1 Kings, or it's a story, rather, that Jesus alluded to. In 1 Kings chapter 17, and He said, "No prophet is accepted in his own country." He said, "But I tell you the truth, there were many widows in Israel," this is verse 25, "in the days of Elijah, when the heavens were shut up for 3.5 years, when a great famine was throughout the land, but no one except this one little widow woman received." What was the key to her receiving? You remember the story goes in 1 Kings that Elijah came. And matter of fact, God said, "I'm going to prepare a widow for you to, and she's going to feed you. During this time of famine, I'm going to bring, you just go to her house, she'll take care of you." I thank God for those little widow women that just take care of you. That will bake you a cake whenever you need it the most. And anyway, He came to such a woman, and He said, "Woman, go make me a cake." And you know what she said? "Oh, I only have a little bit of meal and a little oil." He said, "We're going to eat this. We're going to make this cake and die." And He said, "Make me one first." Do you remember the story? 1 Kings. If you don't, you can look there. 1 Kings. And so what it says is that she went in, and she brought Him some water, and she made Him a cake and gave it to Him. And you know what He said? He said, "You know what? Your meal is never going to wear out. You are never going to do without oil or meal throughout this entire famine. You're going to have an abundance." This one widow woman received an abundance when everybody else was starving to death. There was a distinction put upon her. What was it that made such a distinction? I believe that she simply believed and simply acted in faith and simply gave that first and honored. And the Lord blessed. She did not put her trust in the natural resources, but rather trusted in the spiritual realities of heaven. You know, I believe that God knows how to open up the windows of heaven whenever by our natural eye we say, "There's no way that this is going to work. There's no way that this is going to happen." But yet in the midst of it, I believe God can open up the windows of heaven upon your house. You're not in the same boat. You don't work by the same economy. You're a spiritual reality. He goes on, he tells about another man. He said, don't you know there were many lepers in Israel during the time of Elisha's reign, and while he was the prophet? He said there were none of them that were cleansed except a guy by the name of Naaman. In 2 Kings chapter 5, it tells about this. It tells the story of Naaman, how that Naaman went to the prophet's house after being told that there was a prophet in the land by his little servant woman or servant girl. And so he goes with all the pomp and circumstance, and he goes and knocks on the prophet's door, and the prophet doesn't even get up off his couch. He just simply yells out to the servant, tell him to go dip in the Jordan River. I guess in his vernacular, his hearing, he might have heard, go jump in the river. It was the key. And so you know what happens? Naaman gets all in a tiff, and boy, he's storming off. I can't believe he told me to go dip in the old Jordan River. I aren't there better rivers in my land? I certainly know of a better place. There's clean ones there. And his servant said, you know what? If he would have asked you to do something hard, you would have done it. So Naaman goes down and he dips. Here's this commander with all of the rank and pomp and circumstance, and he dips 7 times. You know, you can hide it once, but after you start doing it more than once, people are going to see you. Seven times. Didn't happen on 6. You know what it says after the 7th time? That when he came up out of the water, that his flesh was like baby's skin. He received healing when no one else was. He obeyed. He set his pride aside. He wasn't depending upon what he could do, because there was no hope for him. But he said all of those things. He humbled himself. You know, it doesn't always come the way we expect it. For Naaman, it didn't come the way he expected. He expected, as a matter of fact, he said these words. He said, I expected him to come out and lay his hands upon me and say some prayer and I'd be whole. It didn't happen that way. God always has his own way. It doesn't always happen like you expect. You see the way that God blesses your life isn't always the way you expect it. It doesn't always come as you anticipate. It might not be a different method altogether, but God knows how to do it. God knows how to vindicate. He always knows how to bring the right message. He knows how to bring you to the right place. But it might take a little humbling. He listened. He listened to his servant girls. He dipped himself. The scripture says he gives more grace to the humble. He promotes them. He resists the proud, though, but gives grace to the humble. God knows how to promote you. He knows how to put you in the right place. Sometimes your answer to prayer might be from a way that he promotes. It might be from a different source than you ever anticipated. So how can we be in a position and a place to receive? Those of you that are Bible readers, you might remember in the book of Exodus. The book of Exodus is all about the children of Israel. They basically had gone into the land of Egypt because there was famine, and they had gone there and they grew so large that they were there in that foreign land. They had become slaves. They had become basically servants, and they were beat, and they were commanded to build. The story says, or the scriptures say like this, that they cried out to God because of the anguish, because of the beating, because of the cruelty. They cried out to God, and God remembered his covenant with them. And he prepared a deliverer. Now, this took some time because he had to get Moses out of the backside of the wilderness and get him back into active duty. But the story is all contained there. Let me kind of fast forward through all the book of Exodus, and I'm not going to hit every point, but simply this, that the way that the Lord delivered the Israelites was this, that he showed plagues, and it demonstrated his power, not only to the Egyptians, but also to the Israelites. As a matter of fact, so much so That there was a distinction that was placed upon them throughout many of these plagues. That there was something that was happening different in their land. Whenever there was darkness upon Egypt, there was light in their camp. So God showed them his power. He demonstrated who he was. And throughout all of this, he then released them by the application of the blood. Moses told him, he said, matter of fact, you need to kill that lamb and put the blood on the doorpost. And whenever you do, he says that the death angel is going to come through the land, going to kill all the firstborn. But if you stay in that house that has the blood covering, you'll be okay. We certainly know that that's exactly what happened. Death angel came through. There was a great mourning throughout all of the land of Egypt. And God delivered them. As a matter of fact, it says they were delivered with prosperity. In other words, the neighbors that were weeping gave them their gold, their silver, their treasures. They gave it to them as they were being expelled from the land. Get out! And they went through. God told Moses, he said, lift up your staff, and the Red Sea opened up and they walked through on dry ground. Again, these people recognized the power of God. They witnessed the whole Egyptian army being destroyed right before them. The largest army of the world destroyed without a shot being fired. God delivered them. He led them with a cloud. He provided food for them, manna, and he provided water for them. He did all of these things for them. They knew his power. It says, but yet in the midst of this, they began to murmur, and they were slowed down. As a matter of fact, there was a whole generation that never got into the possessions or into the promised land because of unbelief. Why do I even tell you that? It's this. Simply because God has a possession for you, a plan for you, a place for you that doesn't change even though you might be far removed from it. It wasn't because they had done everything right that they had this great possession that God had prepared for them. It was a place that the Lord was leading them to every step of the way. It took them 40 years when it should have taken them 11 days. It should have been a short walk, and instead it was a year, and generations were lost because they didn't have the faith to receive it. God had the possession. He had the promise, but they'd never received it. So how do we receive? What can we learn from that? How do we position ourselves to receive from God? I believe number one is this, that we have to have faith. That faith, we have to receive. Everything that we receive spiritually is always by faith. It's not the way it looks. As a matter of fact, you get in agreement with the way it looks, you'll be like the spies that said, there is no way that we can go up into that land. The spies said, the giants are up there, the cities are all walled, there's no way that we can do this. Everything you receive has to be out of faith. It was the faith that caused that little, the widow woman to receive. It was faith that caused Naaman to receive. I believe Hebrews chapter 11 says it this way, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. He is a rewarder. He is one that brings about the possessions and brings about... It's not because they were so good. It wasn't because they laid claim to it. It was rather because God had given it to them. His word tells us what he has given us. Joe quoted from the book of Psalm 103 today. And forget not all of thy benefits, who forgives all of our iniquities, who heals all of our diseases, who crowns us with loving kindness and tender mercies. I believe that those are possessions that God has for you. It's a place that he wants to take you. Even when we've messed up, even when we're in bondage, even when we've walked away, God has things for us that he wants to give us. The book of James says it very clearly. He said, you've got to ask in faith. James 1, 6 and 7. And he said, if you waver, he said, you'll be like a wave in the sea. He said, don't even let that man think that he'll receive anything. It's got to be received out of faith. Verse 17 goes on in that same chapter, and it says it this way, for every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, in whom there is no variableness, no shadow of turning. In other words, he doesn't change his mind because of what we might have encountered throughout this life. There's no variableness. Doesn't change his mind about you. Faith in the Lord. Faith in him. Faith in the Lord of the harvest. He's just looking for God's people that will receive it. He has the harvest. We have to receive it by faith. To being faithful. You say, well, the Israelites, they didn't have faith. How is it that they received? There was a man by the name of Moses that lifted up that staff. You see, in your home, you say, I'm the only one. Will be the Moses of your house that will lift up the staff over and say, we will go through, we will be blessed, we will be the possessors. We will be, in Jesus' name, we will be the house that God intended us to be. By faith. Let's go on to that second one. We've got to be patient. Patient. You must be patient. You ever heard about the story about the man that he was talking to God and he wanted to know a little bit more about God. He said, God, he said, I just want to know what it's like up in heaven. He said, what is it really like? He said, what's $1 million to you? God answered, well, it's like a penny. And the man said, He said, well, what about time? He said, well, you know, I just had a birthday. What about time? He said, what is a million years? He said, it's just a moment. Man got an idea. He said, God, can I have a penny? The Lord said, just a moment. Patient. You realize that we're not on God's, that you are not in charge of time, that we're on God's time, that he's not on your watch. Farmers have to be patient. It tells us in the book of James chapter 5, he said, the husbandman waits for the precious fruit of the earth to come about. Harvest time. In the book of James, he shows us patience, letting it mature, letting it come. The book of Ecclesiastes chapter 3 shows us that God has a perfect time for everything. To everything, he says, there's a time, there's a season for everything under the sun, even under heaven. There's a time to be born, a time to die, a time to plant, a time to pluck up. There's a time. God's promise is reaping if we won't give up. You remember what he said? Let us not be weary in well-doing, for in due season you shall reap if you don't give up. You don't quit. A perfect time for all things. You see, God wants you to possess what he has given you. Let's go on to number three. This is one that maybe we forget about and one that we don't necessarily see in our lives. Number three on your paper, position to receive. It's hard work. I know you've never heard that one. We just thought we laid on the couch and we got it. You thought that you just laid in the lazy boy and the mailman delivered it into your mailbox. It's hard work. I've never worked on a farm. Some of you probably have picked horseradish. Has anybody here picked horseradish? There's a few. Tell you what, if you've ever done it, apparently it leaves such a scar on you that you talk about it quite a bit. I think everybody that I've ever known that picked horseradish told me about it. Because it's hard work. Whenever you hear about those that pick cotton, you hear about people that have picked cotton and they talk about the hard work. Can you imagine getting paid by the weight with cotton? And in the midst of this, anytime there's harvest, whether it's harvesting the horseradish, harvesting the cotton, harvesting whatever, harvest time is hard work. It's the hardest time. As a matter of fact, let me just say it this way. Whenever God promises us the harvest, we have to understand that the harvest is in the field, not in our fridge. That the promise that God made for Israel was that they will have a land flowing with milk and honey. He didn't tell them that they had to milk the cows and they had to steal the honey. It was there. It was all there. But they had to take it. They had to possess it. God's promises that he makes to us. You know what he even says? He said, pray the Lord of the harvest that he send forth laborers, toilers, It's a word. It means to toil. It doesn't mean that you lazy back. It rather means that you work for and you take it and you receive it. And sometimes you can't even see it with your natural eyes. To understand the harvest time, you've got to expect there to be a harvest. Whenever you go out into your garden, you look for it. We had a tomato plant, and boy, I'll tell you what, we kept looking for that one tomato to ever, it was going to, I knew it was going to come to ripeness, and so did every bird in the neighborhood apparently, and they were all watching it, and they got there first. I was expecting it. You know, you got to watch for that fruit. Sometimes you don't even know what you're looking for. In Guatemala, they have this little wooden bowl of fruit, and they were all carved so pretty, and they had this one that was about like that, had a little thing up on the top, and they said, "You know what that is?" I said, "Well, it looks like a pear, maybe upside down." And they said, "That's a cashew. The cashew grows up here on the top, and then there's this fruit." I would have missed it entirely. I love cashews. I would have walked right on by that. Sometimes we have to know what to expect. Sometimes whenever we're praying, "Lord, give us a harvest of souls," He's given us people that knock on our doors at inopportune times. He's given us people that contact us through Facebook that we haven't even talked to in years. Boy, that was weird. I bet they just wanted to know about my family and how good I look after high school. No, sir. Then maybe it's the Lord giving you the harvest, and we didn't even realize what He was doing. Sometimes the Lord gives you more work down at the shop. Oh, I'm wearing out. Lord, should we pray to stop that work? Not at all. It's the Lord providing. It's the Lord giving His provision. Sometimes we have to understand that we have to recognize the work. We have to recognize the 10 spies that missed it. The 10 spies that all they saw were high walls and big people. They missed out on the harvest. They missed out on the possession. Every one of those 10 died. Only the two that saw received. Caleb and Joshua. God gives us the promises in prayer, and we still have to see it through. We have to continue to pray it through until it comes to pass. God gives you a great business plan, but it's up to us to act upon that business plan. God drops into you some wisdom. He expects us to take that wisdom. Amen? If we're going to be in a position to receive, I think we have to understand it's sometimes hard work gathering in the harvest. Book of Psalm says 126, he says, "He that goeth forth weeping, bearing precious seed, shall doubtless come again. Rejoicing." You say, I'm just weeping. But they'll come in rejoicing, bearing precious seed. They will receive that blessing, and they'll bring with them sheaves, the harvest. Let's go to that last one. The last one is this. If we're going to be in a position to receive, I believe we have to be thankful. Thankful for who He is. Thankful for all of the things that He has given to us. Thankful for what He has put within our hands. Sometimes we miss out on more because we haven't used what we've got. We've already talked about that last week. Thankful. Let me close with this story. It's this. Jesus came through one day and He saw these 10 men. 10 lepers, and healed, cleansed them, 10 of them. You know the story as it goes, and perhaps those of you maybe have read it or heard it told before. As the 10, he said, "Go show yourself to the priest, you're cleansed." It says they took off, and then one of them, you remember the story? That one of them comes back to Jesus. And he fell at His feet, and he was thankful and grateful. And you remember what he said? Jesus told him this, "Thy faith has made thee whole." Complete wholeness. Sometimes we're satisfied with just getting relief when God wants to make us whole. Sometimes we're satisfied just to get some stuff. Give me a candy bar when God wants to heal you of the craving. Sometimes we're satisfied with just a little bit whenever God has the abundance. Sometimes we're satisfied with just a little touch. when he wants to come and live with us? How many times have we missed out because we have not been made whole? Maybe the Lord answered your prayer, but I'll tell you what, maybe instead of just answering a prayer, he wants to be your friend. He's with you all the time. The key to receiving is understanding who he is, accepting him by faith. The book of John at the bottom of your paper says it this way. Jesus came to his own, and his own received him not. But to as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God. Gave him power to become. God wants to give you power. What's the key to it? Receiving him. Jesus knocks on every heart's door, wanting to show himself strong on your behalf. Wants to say, hey, I'm here. Wants to give you his blessing. Will you allow him? Will you receive him? Will you come to him? You don't have to just get the stuff. You can become a son, a recipient, blessed, a daughter of God, healed, whole, living in abundance by faith. Pressing in, reaching on, patient and saying, Lord, I trust in you and your timing. Amen. Now, Lord, I pray that as we bow our hearts today and allow your word to be sealed into our hearts, we pray that you would come. Come into this place. Touch our lives, we pray, in Jesus' name. I'm going to ask